I've braved the elements to discover what amazing megastructures need to survive, and I've noticed that one thing links them all. Each contains a moment of genius, a single invention, without which big could not exist. I'm traveling to the desert city of Dubai, where the tallest building in the world, the Burj Khalifa, towers 828 meters into the sky. But this cloudbuster would never have been built without an invention that we all take for granted. There's no way anyone living or working in this towering skyscraper is going to take the stairs to climb 163 floors. The only reason this mega building can function is because of one man, Elisha Otis. 19th century elevators were simple platform hoists fraught with danger if a cable snapped. Then in 1853, Elisha Otis, an American industrialist, invented a system of ratchets and safety catches which, in the event of a fall, automatically locked into place.
If I get this wrong, do I plummet to my death?
A new, safer elevator was born. And now, if a cable snaps in the Burj Khalifa, disaster is averted.
I've never ridden on top of a lift. Do we get crushed to death when we get to the top?
Today, elevators are like express trains to the sky.
So, how high are we going?
We will go to level 153 now.
It's not often do you see numbers going that high on the buttons in a lift, is it?
I don't think you can see it anywhere else.
Oh, my ears are popping.
The Burj Khalifa is more like a vertical city. Its 57 elevators are a mass transport system, ferrying 800 people at any time across 163 floors, faster than a subway train.
So, how far up the building are we here?
We are 448 meters.
This is only halfway.
Elisha Otis isn't the only man coming up with big, life-changing ideas. Halfway across the globe, back at the port of Rotterdam, I want to introduce you to another man whose stroke of genius changed the global economy forever.
This port and global trade as we know it would never have happened without these steel boxes. 90% of what we eat and wear is shipped around the world in containers like these. And we have a man from North Carolina to thank for them. Malcom McLean, of whom there happens to be a photograph stuck to the front of this container, was a very impatient man. He got cross and bored waiting for cargo to be loaded from the ship onto his truck, so he invented a steel box to put the cargo in so you could move the box from the ship to the truck and back.
Because McLean's metal boxes were a standard size, they could be stacked on top of one another, and so was born the shipping container. Back in the 1950s, ships could accommodate around 50 of them. Today's megaships can carry over 20,000. Cranes in ports and even trucks have been designed to carry them, and at any one time, there are 20 million containers in service globally.
The beauty is the simplicity of it. This invention has been compared to the invention of the wheel. It changed the world. Malcom McLean, he was a clever trucker. Ooh, hello.
Right, I'm here.
Look, I'm back at the VW factory. Whilst American Malcolm McLean's invention transformed shipping, an engineer from Japan did the same for mass manufacturing. But he didn't invent an object, he invented a process that changed how and when factories took delivery of the parts they needed on the assembly line, enabling this VW car plant in Germany to be the biggest car factory in the world.
I shall now demonstrate the principle that revolutionized mass production by setting up a very modern sandwich factory. So here's the story. The traditional American model of car manufacturing was to get in all the parts you needed to make a load of cars all at once. That's my sandwich ingredients here. It took up a lot of space. Then to set about making a load of cars. Any color at all, just make them and put them out and hope people bought them. Like my big pile of sandwiches here. Then in the 1950s, along came a guy called Taiichi Ohno from Toyota who realized, that's ridiculous. And he said, wait a minute, why don't we wait until somebody's ordered a car and then order in the parts we need to make it to arrive just in time to make it? Then we know it'll go. It was efficient, it was fast. It's now the way pretty much everything mass-produced is made. So these are orders for sandwiches that have come in from the crew. Over here is my new, smaller, streamlined warehouse. This is right next to my factory, from where they're going to hold just about enough stock for the next 3-4 sandwiches, which you're going to deliver to me on my assembly line to put together in sequence and just in time. Right, over here are our suppliers. They have a list of what's needed for the next 4 sandwiches each time of their own particular products. So they will be supplying to my warehouse. My warehouse will be supplying them to the assembly line, and I'll be assembling them. It's utterly brilliant, and it really can't go wrong. OK, could my remote suppliers please supply the warehouse with sufficient ingredients to make 4 sandwiches? Put that on there, thank you very much. Just-in-time delivery of that. First sandwich is done. Next one, come on. When you consider that a car is made of 10,000 parts from 2,600 suppliers from all around the world, you realise how much bread and cheese that is and how precise delivery has to be. Quick! You've stopped my assembly line and you've dropped a tomato. We are not stockpiling cars, remember. In this example, each of these sandwiches has been ordered already. Sandwich ready. See, I don't think we could possibly have done this more quickly and by occupying less space with sandwich ingredients than we have done so far. Thank you very much. In my mind, I thought this might go horribly wrong, but these guys are, yeah, they're scientists, they're engineers, they're also Germans. Taiichi Ohno's just-in-time plan increased productivity and profit. And guess what? The idea caught on fast. So that now, thanks to this innovation, this mega car factory in Germany can turn out 800,000 cars a year. Thank you, that was irritatingly brilliant. Thank you very much. Our new modern sandwich factory is open and available to take orders. Taiichi Ohno's innovation didn't just make mass manufacturing more efficient, it's the reason we have so much choice in what we order. But if I had to choose my favorite invention, it's the one that revolutionized air travel and made big aviation possible. The jet engine. Invented by Frank Whittle in the 1930s, the jet changed the world as we know it and powers everything from passenger jets to huge military cargo planes.
I can feel it in my chest, the power it takes to get that into the air.
It's allowed aircraft to fly further and faster. And as planes have gotten bigger and bigger, so have the engines. This monster is the GE9X, and Dave Groff is going to tell me how and why it's so big.
This is it, Richard.
Yeah.
This is the world's largest and most powerful jet engine.
That's the kind of stats, that's an absolute, that's it.
This whole engine is the size of the fuselage of a Boeing 737.
Just the engine.
Just the engine. 134,000 pounds of thrust in the Guinness Book of World Records, just as of last week.
This beast of an engine delivers more thrust than the rockets that put the first Americans in space.
What did you have to do then to make this the biggest and most powerful jet engine in the world?
Well, we've had to use all our latest technology, right? We have ceramic matrix composites. We have 3D printed parts in this engine. And we've advanced these fan blades, okay? These are carbon fiber fan blades, and they're bigger and badder than all of the other engines we've done before.
Is this as big as you can get? Is this it?
That's classified, Richard. Do you want to give it a spin?
Just push it that way.
Yep.
I treat this as though it's delicate. It must be the toughest thing I've ever encountered.
It's super tough. You can do it.
And that's this whole vast thing.
That's
how the bearings are.
That's it.
That is absolutely monumental.
It's pretty amazing.
I don't want to be in here when it's at full speed.
At any given moment, there are 1.25 million people in the skies in aeroplanes being powered by jet engines. The world is now a much smaller place. And it's all thanks to Frank.